Welcome, and thank you for joining me for this special series, Intro to GraphQL, Part 2. My name is Brandon Minnick. I'm a developer advocate at Microsoft. If you haven't already, make sure to check out Part 1 in this series, where we introduce the concept of GraphQL. In Part 2, we're going to explore an existing GraphQL API endpoint, and specifically, we'll be looking at GitHub's API. So in my browser, I've navigated to GitHub's GraphQL API, and we have a graphical user interface called GraphQL that we can use to explore the API. Now, one of the really neat things about GraphQL is that it's self-documenting. Here on the right, we have this documentation explorer, and this is going to allow me to learn everything I can do with this GraphQL API endpoint. Now, I see here query and mutation. These are the two root types for GraphQL, and query is the equivalent to a GET request in REST. Query is going to just return back data. It's not going to change anything server side. And mutation is the opposite. This is the equivalent to a create, an update, a delete. This is where we'll be changing data server side. So let's explore a query that we can put together today. And when I click on query, it shows me all the different options that I have for the GitHub GraphQL API. And it's all the things we expect, like I can query for organizations, I can query for repositories. And what I'd like to do today is query for a user. So here on the left, I'm going to type query, and I'm going to query for a user. And you can see we get some IntelliSense, which is really nice. And it tells me that I need to specify the user's login, and I'll put in my GitHub user account, brminnick. Now, I'm getting some red squiggles, which is telling me that user must have a selection of subfields. Did you mean user open curly bracket? And I did, because if you remember from part one, GraphQL requests only return back the fields that we specify. And in this case, I haven't specified any fields yet. So let's see what fields are contained in user. So user, I can see, let's see, the user's bio. So I can type in bio. I can type in, let's see, it looks like company. We can see things like created at, the date that my GitHub account was created. And now when I click go, this performs the GraphQL request and returns this JSON response of exactly the data that I requested. So now I can see my GitHub bio, Xamarin App Developer, company Microsoft, and that I created my GitHub account in 2015. Now, what you might notice is that we have JSON data on the right in our response, but the query on the left isn't actually JSON. So how do we use this from the client side? Well, let's do that in my favorite client-side application, Postman. So in Postman here, I've entered in the GitHub GraphQL API endpoint, and I've selected post. Now you might be thinking, wait a minute, post is a REST API thing, and we're talking GraphQL. Well, it turns out every GraphQL request is just a post request. So if you're already familiar with how to make post requests, you know how to do a GraphQL request. The only difference is in the body. So every GraphQL request just takes in one field, and that field is query. And query is a string. And the string that we enter is exactly the query that we figured out here in GraphQL. So if I copy this, I can paste it here. And let's go ahead and get rid of some of those carriage returns in the white space. There we go. And when I click send, look at that. We get back the JSON response from the GraphQL API. We get back my bio, company, created at. And what's really cool about this is as a mobile app developer, I want to make sure that I'm using as little of your cellular data as possible. I want to make sure that I'm using as little of your battery as I have to. So what I love about GraphQL is I only have to make one API request. And let's say Let's say I didn't need the created at field. Well, with REST, I would have to go and I would have to create a new REST API endpoint just so I can get back a different shape of data. But with GraphQL, I can just remove created at and send that, and now I get back only the information that I need. Or maybe I want more information. Maybe I want to know how many people follow my GitHub account, and I want to get the total count of followers. Well, I add that in, and now I can get back the total count of followers. So I don't need to create a new API endpoint every time. I just can format the query and change the shape of the data to match exactly what I need for my app. Now, something else I want to look at real quick is, let's look at the size of this payload. It's about 1.27 kilobytes. Now, the GitHub REST APIs are still available, so let's compare this against what we would do for GitHub's REST API. So the first thing we would need to do, I would need to send a GET request to github.com/user/brminic, and then this is where I can get information about the company and the bio, and it also tells me the follower's URL. So that means I have to make now a second request to /followers. And remember, I only want to know the total count of followers, but when I click send, it's going to return back all of the information about everybody following my GitHub account. All that information that I don't need because I just wanted the number. And look at the size of this payload, 27 kilobytes. This is an order of magnitude bigger than the GraphQL request that we created just a moment ago. So with GraphQL, we can make our requests faster, smaller, more efficient, and we don't need to create unique REST API endpoints every time, making our development process much, much faster. I'm so glad you could join me today. If you're interested in learning more about GraphQL, check out the links below. Thanks.